to the Eating at a Meeting podcast. I'm your host, Tracy Stuckrath, dietary needs expert, certified meetings manager, certified food protection manager. I have searched the globe to find people and businesses who are creating safe, sustainable, and inclusive food and beverage experiences for their employees, guests, and communities. In each episode, you will find authentic conversations about how food and beverage impacts inclusion, sustainability, culture, community, health, and wellness. I know that sounds like a lot, but we're going to cover it all. Are you ready to feed engagement, nourish inclusion, and bolster your bottom line? If so, let's go. Hey, everybody. Welcome back to another episode of the Eating at a Meeting podcast. I'm your host, Tracy Stuckrath. So this episode of the Eating at a Meeting podcast is dropping on April 8th, which is Global Meetings Industry Day. And this is a worldwide effort throughout the meetings industry, events industry, hospitality industry, to promote meetings and events, to promote the expertise and the value we bring to creating experiences, whether in person or virtual, that it's the importance of meeting with other people. And the theme of 2021 is MeetSafe. And today's conversation that I'm going to bring about is about meeting safe, but as it focuses on food and beverage experiences. So I hope you learned something from it, and let's get started. In today's show, I'm on my own. I'm the expert, and we're going to focus on an Instagram story that I saw from my friend Ali Bon, otherwise known as Miss Allergic Reactor on all social media platforms. Again, that's Miss Allergic Reactor. She did an Instagram story last week that I thought was wonderful, and it was, the title of it was, Focus on What You Can Control When Traveling with Food Allergies. And there's a lot of that, a lot of things that we can control. So I want to focus on that because I think learning from her, a person who's traveled the world with multiple food allergies and environmental allergies, she has learned and she teaches others and she shares with others how she has traveled the world to places that I just have dreamed about going with these multiple food allergies and environmental allergies. And she's got a lot, we can learn a lot from her. So what I want to do today is go through the six steps that she's outlined in a blog post that she then took into an Instagram story and see how we can learn from that as meeting professionals, whether you're the planner, the convention services manager, the chef, the server, the sales manager even, and really look at what we can do. You can also, she was a guest on my show last year. She was episode number 47, How to Live and Travel Confidently with Food Allergies. So go back and listen to that one if you haven't. But right now, today, we're going to talk about what we can control with managing dietary needs of our events. And before I get in, one more thing. Before I get in, I know that this is a challenge. I am a meeting planner. I am also someone who has food allergies. But when I started my Eating at a Meeting Facebook group last year, and if you haven't joined, go find it. It's free to join. The Eating at a Meeting Facebook group, I ask all people who enter the group or want to join the group, what are your biggest challenges with event food and beverage? And what do you want to learn about event food and beverage? And hands down, the number one answer for both questions is, how do I feed everybody? How do I make sure that I accommodate my attendees with different dietary restrictions? How do I make sure that I keep people safe? It literally is about the dietary restrictions because meeting planners are getting requests left and right from attendees wanting to saying, hey, I'm allergic to this or I'm kosher or I'm this. And it's a challenge when you're trying to feed, you know, 50, 100, 1,000 people at one time. You know, and you have a bunch of people with different dietary restrictions. So how do you do that? The number two and three responses for those two questions are safety. And because I launched it in COVID during the middle of the pandemic, the third reason was, how do I accommodate people during COVID? How do I make sure that everybody feels safe? So I know that I'm not the only one that finds a challenge in this. My almost 1,000 members of that group have said the same thing. So again, we're going to look at what we can control with dietary restrictions and how we can help our attendees control their experience and feel safe and included when they're eating at our events. So let's get started. The number one thing that Allie points out is that she can control what she knows. And again, I love this because it is about knowing your food allergies and knowing your other dietary needs, if it's celiac or if it's kosher or, you know, veganism even. You know more about your dietary need. She does a lot of research on what that is, but you know, an example would be if she was allergic to eggs or if you had somebody allergic to eggs, you would know that when you're looking at a prepackaged item, you know, and you're trying to find out if it contains eggs, you're going to look for the word egg, of course. And in the US and Canada and the European Union, and actually, I think it's 22 countries around the world, egg is one of the top allergens that must be labeled on prepackaged foods, and in the EU on unpackaged foods as well. But when you're looking at a prepackaged item, it needs to spell out that it does contain eggs. But words that would think of it would be like globulin and ovoglobulin, and anything that begins with the word ovo, O-V-O, that means that there's egg in that item. Or if you're thinking about milk, somebody says they're allergic to dairy, that would include milk and ice cream and whey and casein and lactose. Those are words that mean that they contain milk. So we need to learn those words and understand that when we're preparing something, if somebody says they're allergic to something, we need to know that. We need to know what to look for. So learning what kinds of food you're allergic to and what other names are there for that allergen, as well as where they are usually typically used in other food products. And if you have environmental allergies, if they're in, you know, your shampoos or your soaps and things like that. So as somebody who is allergic to something, you can control by knowing more about your allergen or your veganism or gluten-free, et cetera. Now, if you're on the meeting planner side and even the chef side, the same thing actually applies to you. You know, if you're responsible for serving food and beverage or selecting food and beverage, paying for food and beverage that's going to be served to someone who has food allergies or to anyone, it's really important to know what you're serving. And so that means educating yourself using reliable resources to know that, hey, that quiche contains eggs. Or that frittata contains eggs, and knowing those things, or your muffins, or your, you know, salads, you know, if it's got crumbled eggs on it, you know, understanding what those ingredients are. An example that I use a lot is from my friend Christina. She posted it on my Facebook group a long time ago, or Facebook page. You know, hey, we're serving salad. A gluten-free salad, but the salad was served in a cone. And that cone was actually like an ice cream cone, not a paper cone, but an ice cream cone. And it actually had dried onions on top of it. Well, it wasn't spelled out on the banquet event order or on the menu that this gluten-free salad was being served this way. And so, except for the word cone. And nobody, you know, checked on what that meant. And so that's where we need to control what we know. And that means asking a lot of questions of our catering partners and of our chefs. And to me, if you're a chef and you're serving food, you should know what you're serving. And that may require keeping the labels of prepackaged food that you're using in your dishes. That may mean jotting down the recipe for your servers to know or your banquet captains to know, to make sure that if you've altered the recipe in any sort of way, that information is documented. A story that comes to mind on that is an event that I attended last year, and actually was one I was speaking at, and it was a green drink, and it said kale and such and such on it. But when I took a sip of it, it it was very frothy, and I was like, this tastes like pineapple. And I looked at the label on the buffet, and there was no pineapple in that listed on that buffet label. And I'm like, this has got pineapple in it. But I took it by what was on the label, that there's no pineapple on it. So I kept drinking it. Well, my throat started to close up, and I went back to the buffet to double check again. And it said there was no pineapple in it, but one of the servers came out and someone else was asking what was in it. And she pulled out of her pocket a piece of paper that she had handwritten down what the chef was putting into that drink. And come to find out, that hotel had two different versions of a recipe with the same exact name. And the chef that made it the first time did not use the one that contained pineapple, but the chef that made the fresh batch when they were running low used a different one that did contain pineapple, but it wasn't communicated, and that change wasn't made on the label. So again, that goes to about, controlling what we know. And that means taking responsibility for what we are serving and knowing that. Controlling what you know. That is item number one. Number two on Allie's list here is I can control what I eat. And that is true when you're going out or you're making something for yourself at home. Or you're choosing a restaurant. But when you're going to an event where a meeting planner and a chef and are responsible for ordering, making, and serving you food and beverage, I, with the dietary needs, don't have as much control over what I'm going to eat because someone else is picking that food out. So for me, the way I advise my clients is that when we're designing our event registration system, we need to ask a lot of questions of our attendees about their dietary needs. And, what are you allergic? Do you have any food allergies? Do you have any other dietary needs that we need to be concerned about when we're designing our menus? And asking these questions up from our attendees is really, really important. And so because we want to be able to control what we're serving, this reminds me of banquet event orders. This is one of my biggest pet peeves with banquet event orders and menus, is that when you're looking down the when you're looking at improving the banquet event order, it says, there is a caprese salad, and then it says, filet mignon and shrimp with a side of, au gratin potatoes. This is not the best sounding meal. But, and then dessert is tiramisu, right? None of those things go really well together, but that's what it says. And at the bottom, it says 25 vegetarians, 5 vegan, 30 gluten-free, such and number 25 no shellfish. We don't know what those people are getting. Right at that point, you should red flag that means chef's choice. You have no idea what's going to be served to those individuals who have dietary restrictions. And so what we need to do is take more control of what we're serving so that the attendees have more control of what they're eating. And that means getting the hotel, the convention center, the catering company to spell out what those meals are. You can control what's being served because you need to know that your CEO is not going to be served a Cornish game hen stuffed with rice that contains mushrooms and he's allergic to mushrooms. Thank you to my friend who gave me that example from one of her events. And when we're trying to help our attendees control what they eat at an event, no matter what their dietary needs are, we need to control what we're serving by knowing more. And that goes back to number one, which is knowing more about what we're serving. So, providing information out there for our attendees. And so really helping others being able to control what we eat is knowing that we need to know what we're serving. Now, number three is I can control what I say. And I think this is an interesting concept from Allie. And when we're trying to describe to people what we're allergic to, she in her blog post, she goes, you know, food allergies are the worst health issue that she has ever had to deal with. She says, I will feel forever grateful for her mom and her dad for, you know, providing a safe experience and life experience and teaching her how to advocate for herself. It is, her allergies are life-threatening, and so she needs to know how to do that. And so when she speaks about her food allergies, she wants to do it as an educational opportunity, as well as a, well, educational learning experience. She doesn't want to have a pity party. She doesn't want people to feel sorry for her. She wants to own it, and she wants to educate you at the same time. And so when we control what we say, we need to be empowered to share our dietary needs. Don't be afraid of them. But don't come at them as being defensive, and also don't come at them as being shy and apprehensive. You know, I don't, as a meeting planner, if you're one of my attendees with those food allergies, I don't want to kill you. So I need you to advocate for yourself, and I need you to stand up and say, hey, I need these foods. Actually, last night I went to dinner with my parents at a restaurant, and I asked for a baked potato with nothing on it. Unfortunately, this is not what I should have done. Unfortunately, I didn't say to her, you know, I have food allergies. I want this baked potato free of nothing or free of everything except the potato itself. And I did not communicate that I had an allergy. I just said, this is how I want to order it. Well, my mom had ordered a baked potato loaded with everything on it. And when they brought my baked potato, they also loaded everything on it. Whereas I got mad. I wasn't happy. And I, you know, I'm like, with people with food allergies, this is important. And, you know, what was put into the menu or what was put into the register to communicate that, you know, I needed this baked potato free of everything. And then did the chef not read that? You know, I don't know what the waitress put into the cash register or to the POS system. And I don't know what the chef read, but to me, I failed in communicating my needs. And so, you know, when we need to give individuals who have food allergies and other dietary needs the opportunity to say what they need. And this comes with designing our registration systems. And my preference and my recommendation is to use checkboxes and not to use open-ended boxes for people just to fill in. Because as a planner, I've gotten those boxes filled in, and it's just somebody's telling me that, oh, I only eat chocolate, right? And that's time consuming. But if you give them check boxes, hey, I'm allergic to this and this and this, utilizing the top 8 allergens, preferably 14 or 22 that are regulated around the world as top allergens, uses your check boxes with then an other box for them to fill in. And, you know, foods that are not included on that list, that would be like onions and corn and, you know, or escargot or, you know, kelp or whatever they're allergic to, filling that in. But helping you streamline it with checkboxes is really a great opportunity for them to share and say what they need. And then also maybe put a box saying, hey, if you need to talk to me, please check here and we'll have a conversation. But as a planner, we need to provide them the opportunity to say what they need to say. And then on the flip side, as a planner, you also need to provide and say what you need from your catering teams. You know, hey, we've got attendees that are vegan. We've got attendees that are gluten-free. And this is how many people that we have. And we need you to provide a safe experience. We need your help to create a safe experience for these individuals so that they get a meal that of equal quality and value, and that they feel included in this food and beverage experience. So meeting planners, we can control how we say it and request it from our catering teams. and catering teams and meeting planners. The other flip side of it is that when we're communicating to our clients and to our attendees, we can control what we say. We can say, hey, this is not a certified allergen-free environment that we're renting. It's not a certified gluten-free environment. It's not a certified kosher kitchen. So please, you know, when you're communicating your needs to us, please put this in your mind. We are going to do the utmost best possible thing that we can do to make you an event, make you a meal that meets your needs. But please know basically our limitations in providing you a completely free, you know, allergen-free environment. You can also control what you say by giving them the menus up front, working with that attendee to say, hey, what can you eat? What do you feel comfortable eating, you know, away from home? And let us make that for you. So looking at it and what we're communicating to our attendees about our capabilities, as well as giving them the opportunity to say what they need to say. Now, you might think that by saying that, hey, we don't have a certified allergen-free environment, or we don't have a certified kosher environment or gluten-free experience environment, you know, you don't have to provide them food and beverage. Well, under the Americans with Disabilities Act, and this is a whole nother conversation that we can have on a different day, but under the Americans with Disabilities Act, because the word eating, as well as all of our bodily functions, immune system, digestive tract, were added to the ADA in 2008 as major life activities, we as meeting planners have a duty of care to provide for our attendees who do have dietary restrictions, because they must eat a specific way as not to be harmed or potentially die from eating that foreign substance that their body does not like. So there is, you know, we've got to do what we've got to do in controlling what we say, but we also at the same time have to provide a safe experience. And that's going to say, I mean, if you're a restaurant and you're, you know, it is an Italian restaurant and you make your pasta fresh in that, you know, environment, you know, putting a disclaimer on there saying, hey, we've got flour in the kitchen. You know, if you want gluten-free pasta, we're buying it out of a box, you know, and we're putting it in a pot of water. That pot of water will be a fresh pot of water, not cooked in the same water as our other pasta, but know that there is, you know, potentially flour in the air and can come down on dust. So, you know, it would be really hard to, you know, do something like that in a specific environment. You know, it's a hard thing to manage, but I hope you get my drift. We still should try to provide something, unless it's an undue burden, extreme change of, hey, I have to redo my entire restaurant to make sure that it's 100% gluten-free. That's going to be an undue burden. So that's another longer conversation as well. Okay, so number four on Allie's list, let's recap the first three, is number one was I can control what I know. So what can you control that you know? What information can you gather about dietary needs so that you're smarter and can communicate clearly on what your needs are and or what you're serving? Number two is I can control what I eat. So it's for the meeting, for the attendee, it's I can control what I eat, but for the meeting planner and the chef, you can control what you're serving and how you communicate that. Number three was I can control what I say. And again, this is the attendee saying, these are my needs. And meeting planner and chef, this is what we can do for you. And here's the way that we want you to communicate with us about your needs. Those are number one, two, and three. Number four on Allie's list, and again, this is Allie Bond. She is with MissAllergicReactor.com. And I am taking her tips that she says that she can control as a food allergic person and educating and turning this into a conversation about how we can serve people with dietary needs at our events. So again, number four is I can control how I act. And it's interesting in her blog post, when somebody who has food allergies, we don't want to live in a bubble. We don't want to stay in our house the whole time. So we choose to go out. We make the decision to go out. We make the decision to go to an event or to, you know, to live life, right? We choose to do that outside of our homes and rely on other people to make us food. But there are things that we can control in how we act. And one of the things that she does is that she wears an allergy bracelet, medical alert bracelet. So in case she does have an allergic reaction, it's there so that other people can see it if she's not able to speak for herself. But, and she travels the world with this, remember? And so she's really good at communicating how she acts. But it's not about just about what you say, but it's also what you do that shows, you know, how you feel about your food allergies. It's owning it. It's standing up for yourself and participating as a human being in a manner that, hey, I'm allergic to this. I hope you understand. What can you do? What can you work with me on to provide me that meets that doesn't have any of these items? Can I help you read a label to educate you? You know, how do you act? And it's how do you portray yourself? And so for me, you know, how do you act is, you know, when you're somebody with food allergies or dietary needs, you know, communicate that form of action of communicating your needs is owning it and standing up for yourself. Whereas not communicating that in advance, sitting down, a server hands you something in front of you and you go, oh, I'm allergic to such and such. I can't eat this. And so you've now thrown that server into a loop. They have to go to the banquet captain. They have to go to the back of the house and say, hey, I've got somebody that's allergic to such and such. They can't eat this. But you didn't communicate that in advance. So that is a form of action. If you're a server, you're a meeting planner, you're a chef, you know, the actions that meeting that a lot of people with food allergies and different dietary restrictions get is a roll of the eyes or a, oh my gosh, I've got somebody else that's asking for a customization of my meals. And that's a bad action. I mean, that's an action that can look negatively against you and towards that person. It's not Allie's fault or it's not, you know, her body is allergic to these things, and if she eats them, she'll die. So it's not something that she can control. And so we, to think that we're providing food and beverage for her and we're frustrated by her needs, that's just an action that is negative in the perception. So how can you resolve that? How can you provide training to your staff, to the servers that are serving food, to your line cooks, to educate them, going back to number one, knowing, you know, about different dietary needs and what this means is really important. Number five on this list is I can control how I react. So again, you know, the one just before this is I can control how I act, and this is one, how I react. So when that story of me the other day, actually last night, when that server brought out a potato that was loaded and not free of everything that I asked for, I got mad. I didn't need to react that way. I can just say, hey, I actually asked for a potato with nothing on it. Can you give me a new one? Instead, I got angry and more frustrated than, well, I was angry. But another example of that is me personally too, is a couple of years ago, I went to a conference on the Americans with Disabilities Act. It was to learn more about the ADA and how to, you know, what regulations have to be put into place to provide for people with different disabilities. And they had asked in advance about my dietary needs. There was a box to input them, but nothing was communicated at the registration desk. Nobody confirmed those needs at the registration desk when I checked in. And when I went to the food function, there was one person standing there, but nothing was labeled. And there was not even a sign to tell me what was being served at all, the name of the dish. And I asked the woman, what's in this? Well, you know, it's chicken cacciatore, whatever it was. I don't even remember. And I just got frustrated. And I left and I was hangry. I was hungry. And so I left hangry. And thankfully, my friend Elisa Hayes was like, Tracy, you own this. You go back there and you say, hey, I requested these a meal without this, this, and this on the registration form. Was this communicated to you? And I did that in a very calm fashion. You know, a meal was brought out to me. It was not the most delicious meal, looking meal or taste wise, but it was a meal that did meet my needs. And so my reaction should have been, hey, you know, not to get frustrated and annoyed, but to go back and educate and ask the questions of the event registration, the team at the event registration desk, maybe have checked in with the banquet captain or the banquet team before I arrived or before I went through that buffet. But the young lady that was standing at the buffet didn't know anything about what was being served except for the main line item. So, but again, nothing was labeled. So how can we control how I react? And, you know, as an attendee, but then as a server or a meeting planner, you know, we need to stop rolling our eyes and we need to look at this as an opportunity to create a better experience for someone. Okay. Number six, this is the last one in Allie's list. And this is, I can control where I go. And I think this is an interesting thing to think about. You know, as a person with food allergies, we can control where we eat. We can say, oh no, I'm not going to go eat at XYZ restaurant because they only have boring chicken with broccoli in it. And that's the only thing on their 4-page menu that meets my needs. I don't want to go there. I'm going to go to ABC restaurant because they have their food labeled, the servers, know what's being served and understand and are very welcoming about it and want to make sure that I've fed something that's nutritious and tasty. But when I'm going to an event, you know, I don't have control over what I'm going to eat. If food and beverage events are included in my registration form, there is somebody else responsible for ordering the food for me. There's somebody else responsible for making the food for me. But how I can control if I want to go there. And to me, that looks like a meeting planner, an event saying, okay, this is what we're providing in food and beverage. These are our policies around food allergies and dietary restrictions. This is our menus. This is how it's going to be labeled. This is, you know, what you're going to get when you arrive. You're going to get a meal card or what. Or as I train and teach my clients and work with my clients, like, let's design the registration form so that it includes more information. So that I, as a consumer, as a person with different dietary restrictions, can make the decision to go to your event. Because I'm forking out $500, $800, $1,000, $1,200 to come to your conference, or my company is, and I need to feel comfortable. And I need to be able to make a decision that I feel safe and will feel included in those food and beverage functions. And so, you know, as a meeting planner, to help your attendees control where they can go, provide them options. If you're not going to provide food and beverage at your event, list out food and beverage event or venues around the hotel or the conference center that are gluten-free or kosher or vegan restaurants, things like that. Help them to make the decision to come attend your event so that they are learning from you, they are networking with your other attendees, etc. So how can you encourage them to make that decision to go to your event? So that's it. When you're, again, let's go through this. These examples or these six tips I got from my friend Allie Bond, who is also known as Miss Allergic Reactor. She travels the world with multiple food allergies and environmental allergies, and she is just a wealth of knowledge. But her tips on controlling of what she can control with food allergies are, I can control what I know. Number two is I can control what I eat. Three was I can control what I say. Four is I can control how I act. Five, I can control how I react. And six is I can control where I go. So as a meeting professional, hospitality professional, how can you help your attendees control those factors if they've got different dietary needs? How can you control the environment to create an experience that they want to come and share with you and your organization? You're listening to this podcast, hopefully, on when it comes out, which is Thursday, April 8th, and that is Global Meetings Industry Day. And Global Meetings Industry Day is about promoting the meetings industry on what we do, how we create experiences for individuals. The theme for 2021 is MeetSafe. And, you know, how are we coming out of the COVID experience to create meetings that are safe and make people want to go to them? How can we do that? And food and beverage is part of that. So as we think about creating our next event, how can you create it so that your attendees can meet safely and eat safely at your food and beverage or at your events? So think about that and, you know, let me know. Send me a note on, you know, at tracy@thrivemeetings.com. Join the Eating in a Meeting Facebook group and make a comment on the video that talks about this as well. Or, you know, just pick up the phone and call me. I'm here to help advocate and encourage that we create safe and inclusive food and beverage experiences. And I want eating at a meeting to be all of those things for anyone who attends, and that's our attendees, our bosses, our stakeholders, our vendors, etc. So thank you for listening to the Eating at a Meeting podcast. I really appreciate it. I hope you've learned something today. Please share it with others. You can find it on all podcast platforms, and I'll see you next week. Thanks, and stay safe and eat well. Thanks for listening to the Eating at a Meeting podcast, where every meal matters. I'm Tracy Stuckrath, your food and beverage inclusion expert. Call me and let's get started right now on creating safe and inclusive food and beverage experiences for your customers, your employees, and your communities. Share the podcast with your friends and colleagues at our Eating at a Meeting Facebook page and on all podcast platforms. To learn more about me and receive valuable information, go to tracystuckrath.com. And if you'd like more information on how to feed engagement, nourish inclusion, and bolster your bottom line, then visit eatingatameeting.com.